there are some people who excel in returns but not bounce pounds and vice versa. Because bounce pounds, there is also a very there's an element of psychology in it, right? Because honestly, at a point where you're like fairly unsure of it, you're looking at the opponent. I mean, you're looking at the teams that has to pass through and trying to identify if they know the answer or not, right? So you're looking at body language. You're looking at your
Personally, I've learned this, and I've learned never to give it away through my body language.
Yeah, I think those are tactics that all seasoned coaches at one point or the other adopt, right? Like they pretend not to know and things like that. It's a very fun element of bounce coaching too. But where this is, it's essentially the, I just now realized this is essentially the opposite of a poker face, where sometimes you are just, throwing away signs that you don't know when you actually know it, right? You're just going away, and then you're trying to recall, and you're just
I
acting
have
like you
done
don't know.
that.
But
I've done
you know the answer perfectly. That sort of a thing.
So on the other end of the spectrum is quizzer shouting no hints.
Worst,
Yeah.
worst.
I think if you talk to other people in Bangalore, they'll accuse me of the same thing. So,
We've all been there.
yeah.
Hello everybody, welcome to another episode of Whose Question Is This? Today we have one of the well-known faces of Indian quizzing, at least in the past 3-4 years. We have with us the boy wonder himself, Pritham Upadhyay. Yay! So Pritham, how are you?
Yeah, I'm getting along. I mean, possibly as good as anyone could expect in these times, so it's fine. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. It's me.
Yeah. So Pritham, we'll dive right into it. Let's talk about your school, the early quizzing memories. That is, so where did it all start for you?
So actually, I'd say the informal quizzing memories for me came from even before school. Right. So when I was in like 4 years old or something, my mom somehow found it prudent to buy this really huge India map, right? You know, the old ones which you had to fold and you could put up on a nail and things, right? So she found it somehow prudent to buy it and then put it up on my room, right? And then somehow it became a daily thing that I'd come back from play school. I think I was in play school, and I'd come back from there. And then in the evening, just before I went out to, play the usual cricket, football and all that, that we'd sit and I try to learn about, I learn to, identify a new state on the map and then learn its capital, right? So basically, that's the earliest, one of the earliest memories I have. After that, my uncle is a very well-traveled guy. So whenever, we'd go on trip, whenever I was on trips with him, what would happen is that I'd badger him to, ask me questions on stuff like mythology and, where he's traveled and all that. And so that became a way of whiling away time while I was on those trips. And so, yeah, he was also the guy who, bought me a lot of books. So he'd be asking stuff about the books I read and all that. And so all this was, a very informal thing. So, I mean, I never knew it at that time, but perhaps these were sort of pointers towards me being curious and me being interested in questions and learning about things in general. The formal quizzing memory, I'd say, started when I was in sixth, and I think this is in 2008, where an invitation for an India quiz came to our school, and then luckily enough, one of the teachers who had taught me earlier, so she selected me. And then we went there, and it was being hosted by Giri Balasubramanian Pig Brain, as we all know him, right? He was hosting it. And then, it was an interesting spectacle because back in those days, apart from Crucible as such, you would have Giri hosting these sort of smaller quizzes, which is now reduced, of course. But you would have it, and It was my first quiz, right? So it seemed like a, you know, a great thing. And it was a very nice quiz. We somehow ended up, you know, qualifying on a tiebreaker, and then we had fun in the finals, right? Ended up winning it to, you know, all of our surprises. But then, you know, that quiz also taught me a very interesting story about quizzing as such, where basically, as winners, both of us got a 1,000 rupee voucher each to one of the local bookstores, right? And I was very happy with it because, you know, I just thought I could buy more Amar Chitragartas and novels in general and all that. And then after that, after giving us those vouchers, they told us ki, we're going to give 10,000 rupees in cash to your school, right? They called it the library fund as such. And of course, after we came back to school, that I don't know where that money disappeared. I don't know if it's even with the institution or with some teacher, I have no idea. But it taught me about, you know, the typical worth thing that they use in quizzes, that what they promise is not necessarily what you get. But yeah, I mean, it was an interesting start and it was definitely fun. So that is the earliest quizzing memories I have. But yeah, subsequently what happened was that we were invited to a few big quizzes in Bangalore as such, which is typically, so I was in Bangalore back then, right? So we were invited to a few quizzes, which are typically hosted by non-schooling entities. So you have the Hindu running the Young World quiz, right? So it goes out to every school. But a lot of these inter-school fests as such, our school was not really well known either in the quizzing circuit or, you know, in general. Perhaps not as well known as some other schools in Bangalore. So we did miss out on a lot of stuff. But then it's, you doing well naturally, you know, get your school into attention, and then you probably get an invite for the subsequent quiz and so on, right? So yeah, we qualified in a few, and then there were a few quizzes where we were competing against 12th standard guys, and, you know, we stood no chance and all that. But even though there was no quizzing culture as such in school, there were, I think, 3 or 4 of us who would regularly just go to quizzes. Apart from that, there was no, you know, quiz club or anything of that sort. What helped was that, you know, whatever, you know, we qualified and all that just got us into more quizzes. Then subsequently, you know, got us more attention as such, got us more invites and so on. So that was what happened throughout middle school. But then, yeah, so after that high school, I moved to Mangalore, and here my school is fairly well known in the city, right? So every quiz, you know, every Tom, Dick and Harry quiz, which would happen anywhere around, we'd get an invite. So, you know, that wasn't a problem as such. So I think these, yeah, informal and then, you know, formal subsequently, these are like the earliest memories I have.
I think your map memory reminded me of something similar, which I had never wondered till now, that I had a big chart of basically all the flags, and that from an early age I was very interested in this, learning all of them, and that helped much later when in my first year there was some tiebreaker question which was about the only country having its map on the flag. So I instantly knew Cyprus because of all that years of prep.
Okay, but though I'm as a Kosovo bhi hai.
A recognized country, no?
Yeah, yeah, of course. So this map has been with us for I think more than 20 years now. Why? Though borders, boundaries have changed, we never had the time to get another one framed. It's like purane ghar mein bhi tha, abhi bhi pada hua aise mein. Same hi hai, ekdam. So I think most people know you as one of the most well-rounded quizzers in the country. And we're not just talking about college quizzes, generally, even if you count open quizzes. So does it come from a reading habit, or as in from a young age, or is it something additional to that?
I think having a reading habit definitely helps. But in fact, something that's more deeper or more fundamental than that is that you have a inherent curiosity or interest, right? Because that reading habit any topic you take, won't develop unless you are curious about that topic or you want to learn more about it and so on. So, yeah, these are like very I had a I, so while growing up, what happened was that I wasn't exposed to you know, as much entertainment in terms of TV or movies or anything. I wasn't really, you know, big into it back then. So what would happen was that you know, I'd watch a lot of sports, right? Anything which came up on TV those days, apart from, you know, the periodic Commonwealth Asian Olympic Games, apart from that, it used to be pretty much cricket, football, and F1, right? So I'd watch a lot of that. But then newspapers used to have coverage of extremely, you know, fairly obscure sports such as 10-pin bowling and all that, and even stuff like, even in cricket, you know, they'd have reports of first division matches and, you know, something as obscure as that. And because it was in the paper, I'd just read everything that I could lay my hands on, right? So I'd be reading these and all that. And so this sort of a habit where, you know, I pretty much read anything I could lay. It's not only restricted newspapers, even, you know, magazines like The Week, The Outlook, which used to be, you know, extremely popular back then and so on. Anything which I could lay my hands on, I was reading, right? And so that, it definitely stems from there. But yeah, I think I was doing that because I'm interested in pretty much everything, and that's an attribute that's almost a fault even at this point, where, you know, you are really indecisive with having you know, choosing things, or, you know, with deciding, yes, what your primary interest is and so on, yes, right? So but yeah, I mean, from a quizzing perspective, it's fun. And also, what is so I'd say what has really happened over my life is that some interests have persisted throughout, right? But there have been other interests which for a period of sometimes even months or perhaps a year or two, where I was really deep into it, right? So F1, for example, it's been quite a while since I've watched, but when, say, Alonso and Hamilton came up, I was watching every Grand Prix and all of that. So there have been periods where, you know, I'm really interested. And of course, as you go on through, you know, your education system and through the quizzing circuit in general, you gain a lot of interest as well. For example, I had almost zero exposure to art before college, right? I knew like a Da Vinci and Michelangelo and a Van Gogh. That's like three of them. That's it. Same. I didn't even watch Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, you know, the two. Right? So that was, so I knew only that. But then, I mean, I discovered art is wonderful in college, and that was primarily due to quizzing. But then, yeah, it's gone beyond quizzing, where you can look at an artwork and genuinely appreciate it for, you know, its aesthetic nature of it. So I think quizzing has helped that way, that it's helped me, you know, broaden horizons. And so it's both a cause and effect thing, where I am reading more because of quizzing, but also quizzing is making me read more, right? And quizzing is exposing me to new things. So that, I'd say, is what, you know, was probably a factor to you, the well-roundedness you speak about.
Okay. So, agla question is slightly loaded. Huh? So, six-part answer.
Aaja question. Huh?
Yeah. Oh, थोड़ा कम हो गया आज के लिए, 17 की तरह होता है। ओके, नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन। सो अ रिटन क्विज इज अ डिफरेंट एनिमल फ्रॉम अ पाउंस एंड बाउंस, व्हिच इज अगेन अ डिफरेंट एनिमल फ्रॉम अ बजर क्विज। यू हैव डन प्रिटी वेल इज व्हाट आई विल से,
अंडरस्टेटमेंट,
प्रिटी वेल इन ऑल थ्री ऑफ देम। सो व्हाट इज योर माइंडसेट व्हेन यू गो इनटू एनी ऑफ दिस, एंड अगेन व्हाट इज द प्रिपरेशन फॉर such quizzes?
No. See, I think, I mean, I understand that there are fundamental differences in terms of the questions asked and the questions that can be expected and so on, right? But I don't really see it as something that we necessarily need to be, you know, prepped for as such or something. I mean, when it comes to buzzer quizzes, I think honestly, you just need, sometimes, I mean, it takes a few questions for you to, you know, get into that mode where you're just, you know, buzzing extremely quickly. Sometimes it doesn't happen throughout a quiz too, right? You're just slow throughout, right? Sometimes, I don't know, right from question one, you feel like you're raring to go and, you know, you're as fast as you could have been. Sometimes it's mindset, sometimes I don't really know, apart from mindset, what else, you know, determines that. Sometimes maybe it's just not your day, that sort of a thing. So yeah, I think the only difference is that buzzer quizzing involves a lot more speed reading, right? So probably, you know, getting into that mindset where you're just rapidly scanning through text, trying to find keywords that, you know, are trying to find out just what the question is, and things like that is the fundamental. And maybe sometimes even being able to guess what the quizmaster is going to ask, yes. Right?
I think even from an image.
I think her having done well in Crucible can attest to that. But so these are some of the things that I think a buzzer quizzer, I mean, when you're quizzing or taking part in a buzzer quiz, I think you must keep in mind as such. I think there's also necessary that there's a more, you know, change in mindset where you basically think that because it's a buzzer quiz, right, that the questions are necessary, are something you might know. There's a higher chance of that, right? So overthinking on a question might not necessarily help. So I think those are some small changes that I think it's probably a lot of it isn't just in your head, that might give you that, you know, extra milli microsecond boost to press that buzzer quicker than someone else. Written quizzes are a lot more right when compared to a typical bounce quiz. Written quizzes is more about because the text is a lot more condensed, and sometimes there might be questions which you might count as trivia based, right? Because there might be one clue at best, that sort of a thing. But I think written is also about just being in that. Again, I think written in some ways might be similar to a buzzer quiz, especially when, for example, when you talk about quiz like Mahaquizzer, where you technically you have, so it's 90 minutes for 150 questions. 90 minutes for 150 questions, right? So you don't even have a minute per question. And there are a lot of things where you take time to recall and so on, right? Written at points is also about just identifying what you know and being able to ignore what you don't know, or just put in a guess and being able to move on from it. But also, you know, the fact that, you know, having a slightly trivia-based background where you can recall proper nouns and where you know proper nouns and things like that can help. Also, I think some of the best written quizzes I have seen have a lot more wordplay, right? Because it's just a condensed text, there might be just even one word might suffice. So, for example, Professor Arulmani spoke about this, and I think it has to do with one of the questions in an older mark, is it 2012 types or something like that? I don't remember exactly when, but he was a guinea pig for the set, for the thing. He was not competing, but they sent him over the set before, and I remember him speaking about I in fact went back and saw the question in the actual mark or two, where it spoke about this scientist in like the 17th century, right, where he spoke about various discoveries in physics and all that he had did, right? And then there was this question where it basically said, but he is known for more, the last sentence of that question basically went, that he's known for more marginal contributions, right? And the question just has to identify the scientist. If you miss the word marginal,
I am thinking Fermat's last theorem.
Yeah, even I thought.
Yeah, exactly.
But I don't remember on what.
He wrote it in the margin that it's too beautiful to solve, something like that.
It's left to the eyes of, it's left to the reader, because it's a simpler thing, right? It's not that hard to solve, that sort of a thing.
Yeah.
So he wrote it in an ancient Greek book, Diophantine's book or something like that.
Yeah.
But so basically, if it's a general bounce quiz, right, or even a buzzer quiz, if this was asked, you'd be looking at the time. You would say you would look at mid 17th century, and then you would look at what other contributions he's had, like physics and so on. And you know, if you can't identify a person from those contributions, you would just put in a you just throw in a guess. Yeah, you'd say Newton, Pascal, Leibniz, all typical guesses of the time period.
That
and
additional word sets that apart.
Yeah. So the best written quizzes out there have such wordplay. So it's, a lot of people, I miss it all the time, and then I go back and then just bang my head in frustration and missing it. Right? But I think that's one of the things that sets apart a written quiz as such. So that and also I think, if you really look at it, try to sort of x-ray through a written quiz and try to find patterns and so on, you'd see things like for a written quiz, because the questions are so short, right? If the person was setting a question on, say, a science question, you see a lot of questions where just the element, identify the element is asked, right? Where you would see things like its etymology and how it was discovered, what it's used, that way, right? So, if you really want to boil it down to patterns, you can definitely find things like that. You can write UNESCO World Heritage Sites, for example, are common. Right, sometimes identifying the city
etymology,
flag, even, all of that, right? So if you really want to go in with that mindset of just I want to ace this one specific written quiz or these couple of, you can do that, and it's not guaranteed, but you have a better chance of scoring that few more points. Those are patterns that recur in written quizzes as such. But overall, I think, buzzer is a different ballgame in the sense that not everyone who does excellently in a bounce quiz or a written quiz can do well in that. But also, I think there are some people who excel in returns but not bounce quiz and vice versa. Because bounce quiz, there is also a very there's an element of psychology in it, right? Because honestly, at a point where you're like fairly unsure of it, you're looking at the opponent. You're looking at the teams that has to pass through and trying to identify if they know the answer or not, right? So you're looking at body language. You're looking at
Personally, I've learned this, and I've learned never to give it away through my body language.
Yeah. I think those are tactics that all seasoned quizzes at one point or the other adopt, right? Like they pretend not to know and things like that. It's a very fun element of bounce quizzing too. But where this is, it's essentially I just now realized this is essentially the opposite of a poker face, where sometimes you are just, throwing away science that you don't know when you actually know it, right? You're just going away, and then you're trying to recall, and you're just acting like you don't know, but you know the answer perfectly. That sort of a thing.
On the other end of the spectrum is quizzer shouting no hints.
I think if you talk to other people in Bangalore, they'll accuse me of the same thing. So
we've all been there.
So apart from the speed element of it, which can be learned through practice or speed reading or whatever, when you just compare, say, an AV quiz or a bounce typical quiz and a written quiz, I think if you're a very good quizzer, you should do well in both, right? I understand why it's not necessarily, sometimes it's not possible because, again, bounce, you're often in teams, right? So you're building upon the other person's guesses. You are throwing something back at him when you can't remember, right? So it is often a teamwork. Written is often solo. So yeah, there are fundamental differences, but honestly, the best quizzes I look up to and the people I see around do equally well in both, right? Or at least they're of a might prefer one over the other, but they're of a similar high standard.
Okay, so Pritam, whenever somebody asks me what to prep on the last night of a big quiz, for example, a crucible coming in, I always tell them go to sleep. That is more important than prepping. So what are your thoughts on that?
Right, considering how my last crucible nationals went, I'd say get mugged probably increases your chances of winning it. That's what happened to me. Like the weirdest anecdote ever.
Okay, we don't know this.
Oh, you don't know this. I think I put it up on Facebook.
I
might have missed this. Yeah.
Right. So this is happening at like 5 a.m. I'm trying to get a cab to go to another area from where I can catch a bus to Majesty. From where I can catch a bus to the airport.
Oh, sorry, I read this. Yeah. Do it though, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm trying to catch a bus to airport. Before that, I'm trying to catch a cab. And then I get out of my PG, and then on the way there, I end up getting mugged. And weirdly enough, that is one rare occasion where I don't know why, but I put a lot of cash. I didn't have a lot of cash in my hand, right? That got me to Mumbai. And also, somehow the robber was benevolent enough to give me back my wallet with ID cards in it, right? Otherwise, I wouldn't have gone past through the airport. Yeah, good robber, extremely good robber. Right. So yeah, the thing which Akhil, my teammate, always found funny about was that I somehow got onto the cab which I had ordered and then got onto the bus and so on. I got on the airport, but he was trying to contact me and I had nowhere to contact him. Right. And then so Bangalore has a lot of airport buses which are definitely coming from different parts of the city. So the hours I had time on my hand, of course. So I literally went around to all the stops near the airport and started, noting down where each bus was coming from. And then I was playing a probability game where I was trying to find Akhil, where Akhil would arrive. Right. And then somehow on one of those buses, after he got on, I spotted him. And then, yeah, of course, I wasn't getting in without him, without his tickets and so on. Right. So I somehow made it to Mumbai. And yeah, that the rest of the day was pretty much a blur. Just relax. The night before a big quiz, I'm often in the mindset of, trying to read as much as possible But yeah, I understand that there are times where, stress inevitably comes in, right? And your brain just freezes over and you want nothing to do with quizzing as such, right? You're often at a point where you decide, this is my last quiz. I'm just done with it. I'm not subjecting myself to this anymore, right? And all that. You're often where you're just brain dead, walking around like a zombie and so on, right? So that also happens. It's fine. I have always been a last minute guy, even in sort of school, right? For school exams and all that. So that mindset has inevitably, continued on to quizzing also. But yeah, of course, there are times when it's better to just take a step back and then, what I know is what I know. Let's just hope that it comes or things like that and just move on. So yeah, it's honestly a personal thing that you've got to find out what works best for you. I don't think there's any one advice that, applies to everyone as such, basically.
So do you think that the knowledge acquired in a quiz is sometimes of no use outside of a quiz? As in it just remains a multi-loop quiz-to-quiz knowledge?
I'd say most times it's true, right? Not sometimes. As you said, there is sort of that, loop where you look at info acquired in a quiz and you consider it important just for the sake of not missing it in the next quiz, right? So things like that. But I don't think it's just quizzing as such which is guilty of this, right? Say you're a sports fan or say you're a cinema buff or anything like that. You tend to acquire a lot of knowledge on that specific topic just because you're interested in it, right? Do all those have a real world relevance as such? Not really. Unless you're say a unless you are in like sports data analytics, yeah, journalist, sports analytics, or you're a cinema reviewer and things like that. Apart from that, right? And a lot of people aren't, right? Those kind of jobs are very, I mean, there are very few people who are in those jobs, and there are a lot more fans and bots who are just, knowing or learning stuff for the sake of enjoyment of it, right? For the sake of their own personal fulfillment of sorts, right? So I think this is what happens in quizzing too. And maybe, I don't know, I've heard this thing where you can, I think Dhar should be able to attest to this better, where you get class participation points or you do better in group discussions and so on, because you can remember random, you can recollect similar examples and so on. So I think the aspects where it helps is that this is just not, you know, what you learn or know for a quiz. Often these are factoids, right? But I mean, if you're genuinely interested in a topic, you then you can get it into a conversation, and you know, that's it's a nice icebreaker at points. It's also, you know, something you can talk about with any person who you know is similarly interested. So that's one aspect. Of course, maybe because you're a quizzer, you dread those GK sections in exams a little bit lesser, right? You don't even the so-called preparation needed for like interviews, group discussions, so on and so on, you probably look at it as something which can be done. Some people have a very pathological fear of it, right? They think you have to know everything in the world and you have to try and learn a lot of stuff before an interview or a group discussion and so on. If you have a little bit of a quizzing background, you'll probably look at it in a slightly more chill manner, thinking that it's something that you can do. Right? It's sort of the self-belief which comes into.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, but apart from, you know, those few occasions, I don't think there's a massive amount of real world. Again, some industries perhaps more relevant than another, right? Things like maybe an advertising where there is, or some inter-domain thing where you need to, you know, take in ideas and events from another domain, try and apply it, or things like that. I think quizzing might help, but overall, majority of things I'd say it's not really right. It's not of a great help, but you do it for your own, you know, joy, so it's fine.
So Preetham, you've won almost everything there is to win in college quizzing. Now, in my mind, that puts a question to how your mind works. Because once you've achieved that, does the desire lessen to continue putting in that effort to win those quizzes? So how do you deal with that?
I think one thing which just helps is that the effort that you're sort of putting into in a quiz, in my case, is not something, you know, exemplary. Or also in some cases, it's not necessarily an effort as such, right? So for example, if I'm reading things that I'm interested in, it doesn't necessarily feel like a burden, right? I'm just doing it because I like it, that sort of thing. So, I am extremely lazy when it comes to, you know, so-called quizzing prep. I won't deny that I've tried it. Of course, I've tried it. What happens is that it eventually feels like your academics all over again. Right. And I think most of us look at quizzing like something which is anything but academics, right? So, of course, I know a lot of people who almost detest it, and I pretty much feel the same way. That effort you try to put in will not sustain beyond, say, an hour, a few hours, or maybe on a couple of days. That's pretty much all you can do. All right. So that is one factor. But I think the other factor is that when I'm in a quiz, I'm going in with two mindsets, right? The first mindset is that of is where I'm competing with myself, right? So where I'm if there's something that I don't know about, right? Something interesting that I don't know about, it has come in the form of a question and I missed it. It's fine, right? I mean, I can't be expected to know everything, or it's something that you have learned about, something new, right? So there is that new learning mindset, which happens a lot more, say, in open quizzes, where there are things that I just don't know about. But yeah, I mean, you go into the mindset of, see, that it sounds interesting, that something you might be interested to check, or you might be interested, you might not be interested, it's fine. But you are learning something or the other. So there are questions which happen that way. But there are also questions which you feel you should have gotten because you know it, or you know, or we should have been able to connect the dots, able to work this out, and so on. So I think honestly, the one thing that I've always sort of found out about myself is that when you're competing with yourself, what happens is that it doesn't necessarily matter, say, what the winning margin is or what the losing margin is, and so on. It boils down to whether you did as well as you could, right? Once in a blue moon sort of a day where you feel that. A lot of days there are things where you miss something, right? You miss something you should have gotten, and so on. And those are the days where, so when you're competing with yourself, there is inevitably a push to, try and do better just in that moment, right? And so I think that's what helps, because when you're in that, you're not, it's sort of an intrinsic motivation when you're at a quiz to do that, right? You're not looking for factors like whether you've won it before, or, how much prize money is at stake or things like that. And you're just pushing yourself to do better because you know you can, right? Or because you know you should have done it better. Then living in that moment sort of helps for me. That ensures that, I don't look at quizzes thinking that, I've won it, what's the point of doing it again, and so on.